Is chocolate good for you? Is coffee bad for you? We've all probably seen the headlines proclaiming a new superfood or a new diet. All well and good, but it should also give you pause, says nutrition expert and author Marion Nestle. She's the Paul A. Goddard Professor of Nutrition, Food Studies, and Public Health Emerita at New York University and an award-winning author. Her new book is Unsavory Truth, How Food Companies Skew the Science of What We Eat. And she joins us now to explain how journalists and science can do better. Hi.
Hi.
Welcome to the show.
Oh, glad to be here.
You've said that this book is more personal than your previous books. How so?
Well, I'm in the story as well as writing about it. I've been writing about conflicts of interest in nutrition research since the early 2000s. I get interviewed by reporters about these topics. I get invited to meetings by food companies. I tell those stories in this book. I felt like I had to do complete disclosure if I was going to be complaining about my colleagues' relationships with food companies. I thought I'd better talk about my own.
Well, let's get into the book. Just on the first page, you write in Unsavory Truth, what we eat is linked to matters of poverty, inequality, race and class, immigration, social and political conflict, environmental degradation, climate change, and much else. Food is a lens through which to examine all those concerns. I love the complexity of food issues and the passion people bring to every one of them. But I do not love the way the food industry has added an unnecessary complication, engaging nutrition professionals in marketing objectives, sometimes against the interest of public health. Mm-hmm. So, why are nutrition professionals willing to work against what you say, the interest of public health?
Well, I think they don't realize that that's what they're doing in partnering with food companies. I think they just think they're getting money for research without really giving it a lot of critical thought. My colleagues, I find, are not aware of the extraordinary body of research that links industry funding to the outcome of research. And what that research shows, and it's from the tobacco, chemical, and pharmaceutical drug industries, is that research funded by those industries almost invariably comes out with results that favor the sponsor's interest. The same thing is true from food industry research.
Well, you said that your colleagues are not able to see this. How did you come to realize that this was an issue?
Well, in the late 1990s, I was doing the research for my book, Food Politics, which came out in 2002. And in doing the research for that book, I kept running across industry-funded studies that seemed just remarkably coincidentally to come out with results that independent researchers were not coming out with. So I noticed it then and then wrote about it in Food Politics. There's a chapter in that book that discusses that issue, and then I kind of forgot about it for the next 15 years. And when I was writing my book about soda politics, which came out in 2015, I came across all this research that Coca-Cola was funding, and that brought the whole issue up again.
You're saying that people don't realize that it could influence their work. Why do you think that researchers dispute the idea that financial ties to industry can, cloud the outcome of their work?
Well, I think this kind of thing, I think we're hardwired not to see these kinds of relationships. We're hardwired to think that we're independent. We're scientists, we're independent. We think independently. A food industry sponsor isn't going to affect the way we design, conduct, or interpret our research. It has no effect on me. I think people feel that way kind of automatically, but the research shows otherwise.
What does the research show?
Well, the research shows that if you get a gift from someone, you're going to be beholden to that person. You're going to want to be nice to them, especially if you want the gifts to continue.
Well, how big a gift? Because I think you say that even a notepad and a pen could affect the outcome.
Well, the research on pharmaceutical drugs shows that larger gifts, vacations and sporting events and box seats at really expensive sporting events have a big effect and a big influence on research outcome. But all it takes is a pen and a pad of paper with a drug company logo on it.
But how is that possible? Because I can see that if somebody was to pay for a trip to go somewhere fancy, stay at a nice hotel, maybe that could be more obvious. But like a notepad and a pen, how can that be? Well, how could that influence your work?
Because that happens at an unconscious level. People aren't aware of it. That's what makes this so hard to deal with. People really feel that they're independent in all of this, but the research shows otherwise.
In your own work, how hard have you found it? Have you found it to avoid engaging with food, beverage, and supplement companies?
Oh, it's impossible. As a professor of nutrition at a university, I'm contacted by food companies all the time. They want to send me information, sometimes very expensive information, big expensive books, teaching materials. They want me to come to their meetings. They want me to meet with their executives.
Is that bad, though, for them to try to engage with people who work in the industry?
I think I have to meet with them. Mm-hmm. I want to know what food companies are doing. Part of my work is to know what food companies are doing. So, of course, I want to meet with them, but I'm very aware that in meeting with them, I'm being co-opted. You know, they want to tell me all the great things they're doing. They don't want me to criticize them. And part of their coming to meet with me is to try to get me not to do that. So I have to be very conscious.
Have you always been conscious of that bias? Have you always been aware?
Well, I don't remember when it first started, but I trace my interest in this back to a meeting that I went to in the early 1990s at the National Cancer Institute at NIH, at which I
heard, NIH is the National Institute of Health. Yes,
it's
I got
the,
it.
It's the big government research institute. And that meeting was about behavioral causes of cancer, diet and smoking. And for the first time, I heard anti-smoking advocates, people who are really against cigarette smoking, show photographs of cigarette marketing all over the world. Now, I knew that cigarette companies marketed all over the world, and I knew that cigarette companies marketed to children. And I remember that one of these people showed a slideshow, this was pre-PowerPoint, of cigarette marketing to children in places where children hang out, around schools, everywhere. This was the days of Joe Camel, who was a cartoon figure.
With a cigarette, very cool looking.
Yeah. Very cool, yeah. Clearly directed at young boys who were members of minorities, clearly directed to that. And I knew about that, but I had never paid any attention to it. Mm. And it was just eye-opening to see how deliberate all of that was.
Were you angry? Were you surprised?
Well, I was shocked. Mm. Because I knew about it, but I didn't know about it. I never really paid attention. And I walked out of that meeting thinking, we should be doing the same thing for Coca-Cola.
And who's we?
We nutritionists should be doing the same thing for Coca-Cola. We should be looking at how Coca-Cola and other food companies are marketing to adults and to children. And so I started paying attention. And the result of that was my book, Food Politics.
Well, I want to show you a clip, and then I want to get your views on this. Last September, we presented a discussion of gene editing in agriculture. And this is what happened. Sheldon, please roll.
And if we're to finish the circle of transparency, then also, you know, Dr. Smyth also, in addition to all his other work, also holds an industry-funded agri-food innovation chair funded by Syngenta and Bayer. And it's just part of the reality of these new technologies that the companies have money to support research.
There's dozens of these research chairs in universities across the country. There's guidelines about control over information, control over data. And I think it's just typically a scare tactic by those opposed to innovation in agriculture and in science more broadly, that these types of concerns would start to come into play. These chairs have been around for decades where industry and universities are collaborating.
So the first clip was courtesy of Lucy Charette. Do you think that she has a legitimate concern over the potential for Stuart Smith's research to be biased?
Well, we know that the industry that makes genetically modified foods has put an enormous effort into making sure that research comes out in its favor. We're seeing that particularly over glyphosate, the chemical that's used with a lot of genetically modified foods. And so this industry has a big interest in making sure that people think that genetically modified foods are safe and that the industry is behaving in responsible ways with a lot of integrity. So I didn't write about genetically modified foods in this book because it would have taken a whole book to do that. But the biases are there. There's research that demonstrates that industry-funded studies have an enormous probability of coming out with results that favor the industry sponsor. And there are studies that show that independently funded research comes out with quite different results. So the industry funding is clearly a source of bias. That doesn't mean that every industry-funded study is biased, but it means you have to be aware of that probability. My degree is in molecular biology, and when I went to graduate school, we were trained to understand that we were biased in favor of getting results that we wanted. And we had to take every possible step in order to control for our own tendencies towards bias. I don't see that happening industry-funded research.
What about the argument for innovation to occur, you need money, and we're talking, you know, not just thousands of dollars, but millions of dollars. What's wrong with getting money from industry if it's going to help innovation?
Well, if it's going to help innovation, that's fine. But I'd like to see industry-funded studies set up with some kind of firewall so that the funder and the investigator are not so closely aligned that the funder feels pressure, consciously or unconsciously, to produce results that the funder wants.
Is the bias that might creep into Stewart's research greater than the bias that Lucy Sharratt might experience given the smaller amount of funding that her organization receives from organic food companies?
Well, the research shows that the larger the funding, the greater the tendency to bias the results. But all industry funding needs to be looked at as a potential source of conscious or unconscious bias. The bigger the funder, the funding, the bigger the problem. But even small amounts of funding could have an effect.
Let's for a moment turn the camera onto us, this organization, TVO. What responsibility do you think we should be taking as the broadcaster of this interview to let our audience know about our financial ties that our guests have related to the issue being discussed,
I think it's a really important one. I don't take any food industry money, although I do for travel. If I go to an industry-funded meeting, I will take travel funds.
But isn't that money, though?
That is money, but I couldn't go otherwise. I'm an academic. I'm not a wealthy person.
So how do you make that, that decision? Where do you draw the line?
Well, I have a policy that I set up that I thought would be something that I could live with. It's not a perfect policy, but it's a policy that makes me think about it. And makes me aware of the problem so that my antenna are up whenever I go to a meeting that's been paid, where my travel has been paid for.
If that was to happen, though, do you think that would, how would the public receive that information?
Well, it depends. There are studies on that point, too. Mm-hmm. And those studies show that disclosure is very complicated. That disclosure, everybody believes that disclosure is a necessary first step, but it sometimes has perverse effects. Certainly in studies of drug industry funding of physicians and physicians' disclosure of their funding to patients, patients tend to trust doctors more if they disclose.
Because they're people of authority.
Because they're people of authority and because they're disclosing, so they're obviously honest. Mm-hmm. But disclosure is only a first step. It doesn't solve the problem.
I'm reading this book, as I was saying to you in the green room. As a reader or as a viewer of our network, How can someone ensure that the information they're getting is trustworthy, that they can trust that information?
Well, I think that's the hardest question in the world to answer. And people constantly ask me that question, and my answer to it is, trust me, of course. But I think you have to listen to what's being said and decide for yourself whether it makes sense to start with. And I have some clues that I use. If it's a breakthrough, that's a red flag that, no, that's not how science works. If it's everything you thought you knew about nutrition is false and you need to completely rethink it, uh-oh, that's a really big red flag, because that's not how science works either. Anytime a study looks at one food or one nutrient and claims that that one food or one nutrient will protect you against a whole range of diseases, you want to be skeptical about something like that, because people don't eat individual foods, they eat diets.
And you're saying that it's hard to actually even track this because, unlike drugs, we eat so many different foods, right?
Yeah, nutrition research is very, very complicated. It's very hard to do. And anybody who tries to simplify it, especially if they're trying to sell something, is something you just want to be a little skeptical about.
And my last question, you know, you write about a lot of different people, about a lot of different companies, big companies, multi-billion dollar companies, and individuals. What's the pushback been like with this information that you put out in your book?
Well, so the book's only been out for a couple of months, and I haven't gotten very much one way or the other. The reviews of it have been excellent. Mm-hmm.
But in the past, when you've written something, you've been disinvited to things, haven't you, or not been?
Oh, very seldom. I mean, it's happened a couple of times, and there have been a couple of threatened lawsuits, but nothing ever came of them. I am often invited to meet with food industry executives, and I take the opportunity to do so every chance I get.
Marion Nestle, thank you so much for being here. It's an eye-opening read. The book is called Unsavory Truth. Thank you so much for making time for us. Appreciate it.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario, helping businesses stay on the right side of change with strategic thinking, insightful decisions, and business leadership. Are you on the right side of change? Ask an Ontario CPA.